Good morning, everyone, and thank you guys so much for joining today. The market's not really doing too much. We're just seeing a lot of consolidation so far in the market today. There's not really any major movers in either direction. Of course, we had GameStop report earnings after hours yesterday, and honestly, like, it's not even really moving too much. I think a lot of people are going to get their options destroyed. It looks like this is going to be a giant IV crush, so we'll see what happens. But besides that, there isn't, like, too much, like, other major news. There was some good, like, jobless data that came out, which was good to see. But then again, it's not really moving the market.
Yeah, hopefully that makes the market go up. But it might be pretty tough, Mike. You know, the market's had a pretty good past few days. And I wouldn't be surprised if we went flat or consolidated. Yesterday was pretty flat, so maybe we'll go up or maybe we'll end up breaking down today. I kind of hope it kind of gets a good move, though. I'd rather it, you know, at least pick one direction or the other rather than just sitting here right around the 470 resistance all day. So hopefully we see some movement, at least up or down. I know Mike, DKS was actually having some pretty good pre-market movement today, and they actually have a dividend, it looks like, coming out, and it looks like they're up pretty big here in pre-market.
That's good to see. And then, you know, even Twitter wasn't looking too bad. You know, it was probably like one of the leading stocks this morning.
Yeah, definitely up above $47, looking really solid actually on the daily chart. I love how Twitter touched it, like that $40 support. It looked awesome there. They're actually extending up pretty well. If we, you know, whenever they open up today in a couple of minutes here, though, they're going to open up pretty high here on the market. It's going to look pretty good. And, you know, honestly, they had a great pre-market, Mike. And, you know, I was honestly like looking through the news and I wasn't finding anything like too big with them. I know that Cathie Wood came out and said that Twitter might play a bigger role with NFTs and stuff like that this morning. But, you know, there's a lot of news, but I'm not seeing anything too, you know, not anything too hyped up, though.
For sure. All right, so we just had the market open. The leading stock on my watch list, Tom, is actually Zoom. They're up 1% today. They're actually looking pretty good. And honestly, I've been waiting for a recovery out of Zoom. Like, they've been reporting some good numbers. And in my opinion, they are pretty oversold.
Yeah, me too. You know, ever since they fell below $200, I think that's been a pretty key price point for them, Mike. And, you know, they fell below it a couple weeks ago. And they just have failed to get back up above that. And I really hope that maybe today or tomorrow they can finally do that. I know that we're only a couple points away from there. And it definitely seems like that with these stocks on the uptrend, Zoom is really liking it. You know, it's had a great past few days. And I'm really glad to see them recovering up, Mike. Like I said, I can't wait to see them get a nice move up through $200 and then possibly start to come back up towards 250, because honestly, they have a long way to go. And if they start recovering, they can recover pretty quickly, I think.
Exactly. I mean, look back throughout history. Like, they go on some pretty major uptrends and downtrends. You know, the most recent trend obviously has been a downtrend, but it went from like 400 all the way down to lows of, what is that, 400? Oops, give me one second. 400 down to lows of like 175. And then, you know, I guess you could say the month before that, they went from lows of like 275 all the way up to over 400. So, in my opinion, they're a good company. You know, they post some pretty great numbers, and I think it's just a matter of time before the market realizes that Zoom's oversold.
Yeah, exactly. And, you know, they've been just getting a lot of bad flack with COVID and everything lately. And I feel like as the winter comes around, you know, more people might just be using Zoom in general anyways. So hopefully that helps them out, and hopefully they go back on the uptrend. I know that we've been waiting for a long time. And, you know, if you guys are looking for some companies to grab some shares of and possibly hold for the longer term, like 6 months or even 2 years, I feel like that Zoom, Twitter, Palantir, a lot of these stocks down here at the bottom are just at some amazing levels. And for the past few days, like, they've been going back up, but, you know, you might miss the boat if you don't buy on this dip. So just always keep that in mind. It's always good to average in a little bit. And talking about Palantir, they're up around 1%, and hopefully they can start to get up towards those after hours highs of yesterday.
You know it. So let's get right into the comments from the stream. And then we have Power just asking about GM, Tom. So General Motors. I know this one's kind of been all over the place lately. We could see today it is down a little bit, but it's like in between the middle of a channel right now. It has some pretty big resistance right around $64 and a pretty big support right around, well, they actually have a pretty big support right at 60, but then there's even another one right at 58. So I would say it's still in the middle of like its channel between 58 and 65. So I mean, it's okay. I mean, I feel like this industry doesn't really have too much momentum right now. Like, I would say most of the momentum is in growth stocks and some of the other beaten down companies. What do you think about it?
Yeah, I mean, I like it. It's just that I'm kind of with you. You know, the main thing, the main problem I'm having with GM and also Ford right now is that they had such a nice uptrend over the past couple of months. And now we have these growth stocks and stuff starting to go up while stocks like GM are starting to take a bit of a dip. And I feel like that GM could end up consolidating for the next couple of weeks as these growth stocks start to fly. And it's just a bit of a transition. I think people might transition out of, you know, maybe these stocks and into the growth. But I do like GM though, and I like the $60 support a lot there. And I know I like the one at 58 too. So hopefully one of those levels holds up for it. But I will say I'm a little worried about it. And I feel like they had a lot of good news over the past like 6 months to a year, and they've been flying up off this good electric vehicle news, and it might start to slow down for a little while before it picks up again.
Makes sense. All right, and then we have Sean saying CHPT on the move. I was just looking at that. So they're up 4.5% today after their wild movement after earnings. And Tom, I'll tell you, like, they're at a pretty big support level.
Yeah, they are, and they're actually almost like up above the price that they were whenever the earnings came out. So that's a really good thing to see. They recovered all the way back, and if they start to go up, I think it would be awesome. They're double bottoming at the $20 support, and what else can you ask for? You know, that's a really key price point right there at $20, and they're still really close to it, around 21 to 22. So it's still a great pickup, I think, for shares. And honestly, like ChargePoint, Blink, and some of these EV charging station companies should be pretty good for the next few years. And, you know, as we start to integrate more electric vehicles into society, we need more charging stations. And, you know, the government's even helped funding some of them. So it sounds pretty good.
True that. All right, Tom. So the next one, we're going to be looking at the SPY. And we have Mass Money saying, good morning. Is today puts day? I might pass because you never know. The market might do a 180. Yeah, I mean, it's definitely possible. I would say it's probably not a smart idea to call it a puts day. The market can easily fall. I mean, the market's down 0.13% right now. But the thing is, like, is it worth the risk? So it's like, if we look back throughout, especially over, like, the past 2 years, like, it's really, really hard to bet against the market. And even when you do bet against the market and you get puts, not only do you have to time it correctly, but then on top of that, you're buying options that are overpriced because implied volatility generally overstates realized volatility. That's a conversation for a different video by itself. But long story short, it's hard to time the market. It's hard to play the market to the downside. And even when you do, you're overpaying for the put. So, like, I just don't think it's worth the risk. But yeah, I mean, the market's down so far.
Yeah, and I think it could be worth the risk as long as certain stuff plays out right. Like, as of right now, I don't think I would just jump in and call it a puts day yet. But, you know, if we see the SPY possibly fall down below like the 466 support or something like that, I think then we could obviously call it a puts day and possibly, you know, get in for like some quicker scalps or something like that. But I don't think I would just jump in with puts yet. You know, the market is kind of coming up here over the first couple of minutes. And, you know, it's never smart to just call it like a puts day just because you think it's going to be like that or because it's setting up or something. I think it's just smarter to just wait for it and then react, you know, like after it breaks down below a support or maybe goes up above resistance or something like that. I think it'll just be a little bit smarter of a way to look at it overall. But, you know, I'm honestly just waiting for a big breakout. If we break out above 471, I think calls will be awesome. And if we break down below 466, then I'm definitely going to be eyeing up those puts.
I would say what I am considering, though, this is just speaking for myself, is that I wouldn't just get, like, you know, puts or a put debit spread or anything like that on the SPY or any stock, just given, you know, how the market has been. But what I would do is do a long short strategy. So, like, let's say you think Apple might pull back, or you think Facebook might pull back, or whatever stock, you know, like, it could be the SPY if you wanted to. Let's say we look at Facebook. Let's say you were bearish on Facebook and you're looking at it for like a quote unquote puts day. What if, and this is just a very common hedge fund strategy, and I made a video on this a couple weeks ago, is like, you can short Facebook and then you can like long the market, or you can short Facebook and then long Zoom. That way, like, if the market explodes up, you know, Hopefully, you hope that Zoom outpaces Facebook to the upside. Let's say the market tanks down. You hope that, you know, since Zoom already fell so much, that Zoom would hold up better than Facebook. And then if you wanted to, you could just like hold the Facebook short position, hold the Zoom long position, and let's say check back in a month later or a couple weeks later, and then hopefully there's a lot of profit to be made. Now, I know there's a lot of variables when it comes to long short strategies, but I just wanted to throw it in there while we were on the topic.
Yeah, definitely sounds like an interesting strategy to say the least. And you know, man, talking about Facebook, they're starting to really break out here up above like 333 here. This is looking pretty good actually today, Mike, for a bit of a move to the upside possibly if this continues. It looks pretty decent and they just broke that high of yesterday. So maybe they'll get a nice run. And I know that we've actually been eyeing up Facebook to the upside ever since it bounced off this 300 support. And man, it's been really recovering, honestly, a lot more than I thought it would.
Yeah, no doubt. Same. Like actually, like I'm looking at the chart and I'm like, it is holding up very well. So I guess Meta is doing a pretty good job.
Yeah, they are. I mean, you know, there's been a lot of hype with them and stuff. And honestly, whenever they were starting to fall off here just last week and they were starting to fall around $300, it was worrying me pretty bad. Like, I'll be honest, this setup was looking pretty rough to me. Like they were just going to break down below 300 and possibly come down and retest like the 280 support or something. But I'm really glad to see they held up and, you know, they're recovering up very nicely. And if this ends up being a nice bottom down here, I mean, who knows? You know, they have a nice metaverse news coming out and they could end up flying, I think, for the next few weeks possibly. But, you know, it's going to take a strong market too. Like if the market starts tanking down, then they might have some issues.
For sure. All right. So I just want to welcome everyone to the stream really quickly. So thank you guys so much for joining. Welcome Mac, Jamie, Power, Mass, Kevin, Jesse, Iranical, George, Sean, Kumar. Thank you guys so much for joining. Tom and I really appreciate all of you. We have Jesse saying, morning, what time zone are you guys in? So I'm on the East Coast and then Tom's in the Midwest. So he said yawn, but I know it's not as bad as all of our friends in California. You know, I think the market opens for them at, it was at 6:30 in the morning or 5:30 in the morning, something like that.
Yeah, it's crazy, whatever it is. I know I'm glad I'm not out there. It'd be a rough morning every day, I know that. But I'm really glad that you know, that we're not that far behind. But yeah, I mean, I'm in the Central time, he's on Eastern time, so that's where we're at there. And you know, it's nicer for me because I get to, well, actually it's nicer for you, Mike, because you get to wake up a little bit later.
True that. Yeah. So I just checked in. Cali's at like market opens at 6:30 in the morning. So
okay.
A little rough for them, but it is what it is. All right. So then we have Mass saying, I bought a Zoom call. Pray for me. I lost $500 in Zoom last year. I need my money back. LOL. Yeah. I mean, it's trending in the right direction so far. It's up like 1.5%, but I would say the quality of your option depends, like that's the most important thing. So I don't know what your strike price is or the expiration or anything like that. But honestly, like I would really consider just grabbing some shares for the long term. You know, they had a great level. They're a pretty good company and they should do pretty dang good over the next couple years.
Yeah, honestly, I think I would just get the shares and not even have to worry about the timing with this one, because, you know, if they consolidate for the next 3 months and you have even a leap option, it could get pretty hurt during that time. But hopefully they just go back up. I think that would be obviously the best case scenario. And one thing to keep in mind is they are getting close to this $200 resistance. I will say they probably have a good shot of at least hitting this and at least having some consolidation before they fly through it. So definitely eye up $200. If they end up breaking through this, then definitely look for a big move, because I feel like it could happen today or possibly tomorrow if they end up breaking up above this awesome psychological level here.
Good stuff. All right, and then we have, let's see, with the next comment, we have Kumar saying, good morning, thoughts on Boeing. So I really like Boeing for the long term. For the short term, they've definitely been a little rough, especially with the new variant news that wasn't good for Boeing. But they are back above the $200 support, which is good. They are struggling to break above that $210 resistance. But I do like them. You know, they're a solid company. They're probably not going anywhere. But for the short term, they definitely took a beating. They're pretty good for shares right now, in my opinion. Pretty good for some short put options, meaning sell to open put options. And I've been eyeing up leaps on them. I'm kind of neutral on the leaps because IV's a little bit higher than I would like. And I just think shares are just probably the better bet.
Yeah, and the IV being high might be warranted with how up and down Boeing's been. I mean, man, this stock's been like a heartbeat monitor over the past year. It just hasn't really, you know, it's obviously it's picked some direction here and there, but man, like you could see it was on a downtrend, but it was just up and down like forever on this downtrend. It wasn't, it's not really moving as drastically as I would have thought. And honestly, I'm really waiting for this breakout above 210, Mike. Like you said, there's been a lot of consolidation here. We've also been kind of tracing the 1000 SMA on the 15-minute chart, failing to break out right here. And Boeing's kind of doing today what I thought more of like the overall market would do. You know, like that's had a great past few days, and Boeing's kind of consolidating slash slightly going down. And I feel like that the SPY might start doing that later on today. So definitely eye it up. But you know, I feel like that Boeing's just consolidating a little bit after doing so well last week. I still feel like, though, they have a good shot to break up through 210, possibly like tomorrow or even early next week.
All right. And then we have Mass Money saying, check Roblox. I think my puts, or you said, think my puts can make a comeback. See a downtrend, ? And then he said, funny, Roblox runs hard all month, and the one time I buy a call, it drops. Yeah, I know what you mean. It's hard to, we need to know like the strikes and expirations on these, because let's just say you had a put at like the 110 strike price for this week. Like Roblox can easily fall like, you know, a couple, like a decent amount today, and you can still lose money. So it all depends on the strike price and expiration. Looking at the movement, I know we talked about this one a little bit yesterday, Tom, and I know I said I was looking at it for like a short collar strategy, and I'm still looking to do that, which is just a bearish bet, but I don't know. What do you think about it?
Yeah, honestly, I kind of liked it yesterday to the downside, as long as it fell below like that 114 support. It ended up not doing that, which sucked, but you know, the stock went up. It is kind of consolidating today. I am a little confused though by his question, Mike, because in the beginning he said, can you check Roblox? Think my puts can make a comeback. And then he asked again and said, you know, funny, Roblox runs hard all month. The one time I buy a call, it dropped. So did you buy a call today at market open, and then you're also holding puts? Maybe that's what's going on, but I'm definitely interested to see what's happening with it. And you know, I really hope that Roblox can get up above 126.50. looks like there's a pretty big resistance up there, and we even hit 126 here right at market open and took a little bit of a dip again. So hopefully we get back up, but we definitely need some more information, like with the strikes and, you know, like the timing, like when did you buy? Like, did you buy those calls this morning, or exactly where did you enter?
Exactly. All right, cool. Tom, I'll say that one of the strongest industries today are actually the China stocks. Like if you look at Baidu, that thing's running. Like I know Baba's holding its ground, but I would say Baidu is the one that's really moving. They're up like 2.5%, and they're like getting pretty close to a breakout.
Yeah, they are actually. Let's see it on the daily. I haven't seen them on the breakout yet, but yeah, look at that, up above 150. I feel like that 150 might be a key level there, Mike. So yeah, maybe they will get a pretty good breakout pretty soon. And I'll be honest, they kind of double bottom down here right around like 135 to 130. I know it was a little bit of a range right there, but it got really close to like 135 before coming back up. Looks pretty good. And I'll be honest, this one might looks pretty good for shares, Mike. And you know, I will say Baidu is almost setting up. It kind of reminds me of like a Zoom or like a Peloton or even like a Palantir or something, the way it's moving. It kind of seems like a growth stock.
Yeah, for sure. All right. And then we have Mike saying, good morning, everyone. Thoughts on SWBI? Let's take a look. SWBI, I've been eyeing them for a longer term play. They're at a pretty good level, in my opinion. Their max weekly chart looks pretty good. I like them, but I just have to do more like a fundamental analysis on them. But overall, like they look like they're at a pretty good level.
Yeah, I'm pretty big into these companies, and I feel like they could be pretty good for the longer term. You know, obviously, the type of market that they're in can be pretty crazy. Obviously, there's a lot of politics involved with like gun laws and different stuff like that. So you always have to be aware of stuff like that. They did have a big drop on earnings lately, which is making it pretty tempting to buy. I know. Mike, like you said, they took a pretty big discount, and it definitely seems like a good way to eye up shares for the long term right now. It definitely had a big drop with those earnings, and I'm really hoping that they start to recover back. Honestly, I think they're a pretty good company, and I don't think that they're going to just go anywhere anytime soon. Their share price is already pretty low, and I'll be honest, like a lot of times if they come out with some bad gun laws or something, that normally makes the stocks go up because everybody, you know, runs the store and tries to buy everything right then and there. So we'll have to see what happens, but I feel like that there'll be a good longer term play. In the short term, you know, expect a lot of volatility with them with all the laws and everything like that.
Awesome. All right, so we have Mass. First, he said with Roblox, he has calls and puts, but he has time with them. So I hope it works out for you. But generally speaking, buying calls and puts is a losing strategy unless there's like a crazy, crazy move in either direction. So keep that in mind. Then he said he's losing all of his money on UAL calls. Any chance they can come back and the calls expire tomorrow? So again, it's hard to answer these questions when we don't know the strike price. Like, we know the expiration now, but we literally can't answer the question if you don't include the strike price. So let us know the strike price. We could definitely help you out there. Looking at UAL, I mean, it is pulling back, but keep in mind, like, they just had a recovery from, what was that, $39 all the way up to $46 in like a couple trading days. So it's like, I don't know, Tom. I mean, I think it's unlikely for it to, you know, retest those highs of yesterday. I mean, anything could happen, but I feel like it's had a pretty big move already.
Yeah, I kind of agree. And, you know, it had an awesome move on Monday, another huge move yesterday on Wednesday. And these were not small moves by any means. Like, these were nice, like 4 or 5% up days here. They were actually pretty explosive. And, you know, it's going to be pretty tough to get back up today. We fell below the $45 resistance now, and then we're also now below the 100 SMA. It's just, it's looking pretty tough for today. I will say he said that his options expired tomorrow. So that's going to make it a lot harder for this to come back. Like, I don't know when exactly you bought the calls yesterday, if you did buy them yesterday, but if this stock goes up, like let's say UAL goes up to $46, you're going to need that IV to pop up quite a bit, you know, to get back up to where you were earlier in the week. So it's going to be pretty hard, I think, to win on it, especially with it expiring tomorrow. It just makes it that much tougher. And, you know, if it expired in a couple months, I think you could end up doing pretty good with it. But with the way it expires tomorrow, it just makes the chances so much less that it's going to be hard. And like Mike said, it already had some pretty big explosions this week. So don't be surprised if it just kind of hovers around $44 and just doesn't move too much to end the week.
Gotcha. All right, Tom, so how's the market looking? I know that today's, I don't want to say like a crucial day, but I know that it's important in the sense that the market has been going pretty strong for, you know, the past week. I know we are getting pretty close to some big resistance levels. Like, how's the market holding up?
It's holding up pretty well, I will say, so far. It's just, it's kind of hitting off resistances and going down as of right now in my eyes. But it, honestly, it's not really doing anything. So we can see the SPY is kind of touching like 469 right here at market open. And then it's starting to, you know, dip down off of those touches. And it's hard to say, you know, it's hard to say if the market's going to come back up from here or if it's going to keep going down. So I'm just going to kind of wait. If we fall below like 467.50 or 467, then I'm going to look at it more to the downside, like I said earlier. But, you know, for right now, I'm just going to kind of wait because the market's not doing anything. And I feel like that as the market goes on today, we might see some movement. But honestly, Mike, I wouldn't be surprised if the market went flat today because we do have some inflation data coming out tomorrow. And sometimes before these key data releases or before FOMC meetings and stuff like that, sometimes the market goes flat for a day before those big numbers release in anticipation.
Gotcha. Crazy stuff. All right, so I'm just doing like a quick scan to see what stocks we have moving. I know we already covered some of the major ones, but it looks like we are seeing some profit taking, especially with growth companies. I know Lucid's down a decent amount. I don't know if you saw that one. They're down like 8%.
Wow, they're actually leading my watch list to the downside by a lot. The next closest one is DraftKings, down 3%. But wow, I cannot believe that Lucid's down this much. I know that Lucid has been really overextended though, guys. So honestly, like maybe we should just expect a little bit of a downwards move with Lucid because, you know, they had a pretty big move this year. I'm not going to lie. Even over the past 6 months, you know, they're recovering up very well from the low of around $17 all the way up to around like 58 to 60 now. So definitely had some nice moves. And, you know, I'll be honest, like if we saw DraftKings triple its price from its lows, we'd probably be saying the same thing about them pulling back. So it just, you know, it just depends on how that movement is. And I'm not surprised to see them down with how much they've been flying up lately, to be honest. And, you know, whenever things go up, you just have to expect that momentum to start to slow down eventually.
For sure. All right. And then we're just trying to see. I mean, you know, while we have Lucid breaking lows, we also have Tesla struggling. They're not bad as – they're not down as much as Lucid is, but they're still down like 2.5%, which is a decent amount, but it's nothing crazy for Tesla. We're also seeing like Coin down a decent amount. Coin's down like 4%. So it just looks like some profit taking, which I guess we can say was expected.
Yeah, and Coinbase and Facebook's and a lot of these tech stocks, they're kind of setting up like Boeing, you know what I mean? Like they're coming up and then they're really consolidating around like 290 on Coinbase's case. And then they're kind of just going flat slash off to the downside today. We can see Boeing kind of is in that same exact setup here. Same thing with Tesla, you know, just kind of consolidating slash falling off today. And, you know, we've had a great week. So, you know, don't be too surprised if we see some of these stocks end up down, you know, maybe 2% today, like what we're seeing so far. It's just, you can't be too surprised with it. We've had a awesome week so far. Like, honestly, we've had almost best case scenario this week with these growth stocks, Mike, like the way DraftKings has recovered and the way that we've been seeing lots of these stocks go up. Honestly, the small little pullback doesn't even bother me too much.
Yeah, me either. I mean, we kind of needed the pop back up, to be honest, because it's like how low are these stocks going to go? And then on top of that, it's not like there was any real bad news with them, like especially like specific to like DraftKings or Corsair or Palantir or whatever. Like it was, like I said, mainly just the transition out of growth and then, you know, the inflation fears. But besides that, I mean, I guess you could say it was a blessing and a curse. It hurt because of obviously all the short-term movement that was bad. But, you know, for the long term, it gave us probably a pretty amazing opportunity to enter. So I'm definitely happy with it after all. I mean, I know the past month has been brutal just with a lot of stocks tanking. But for the long term, it should definitely pay off. But I'm definitely excited for it. And like you said, like I'm not really too concerned with this, you know, down day today, considering for the past couple days, we've had like back to back, like 6% up days.
Yeah, exactly. And, you know, the market is moving down a little bit today and, you know, stocks are consolidating. But like we talked about a little bit earlier, Mike, there has been some amazing news come out. I'm just pulling up the article here really fast, but there's been some amazing news come out with the jobless claims. Apparently the weekly jobless claims fell to 184,000, the lowest level in more than 52 years. Like, Mike, that honestly sounds pretty good, but it seems like the market, you know, I would have expected a pretty good move if the numbers were the best in 52 years. But, you know, like we said, they had such a good past couple of days. I guess it just had to consolidate a little bit, kind of like what we're seeing here with the SPY and with a couple of the others. But I did just want to point that out, though, that while stocks are going down because it's just the natural movement, we did have some good news, though. So maybe this will boost some confidence maybe for later in the week or maybe for next week. I feel like it'll be some really good numbers. And honestly, like if the inflation numbers come in tomorrow and they're good, I think that the market will love that. And then possibly we might even hear Powell maybe hype up the market or something at the FOMC meetings next week.
True that. All right. So, yeah, I mean, we do have some big news coming up, like Tom suggested. So yeah, it's good to see. And then Tom, I know that there was a lot of hype with DWAC yesterday. How's that looking?
Wow, it's actually doing pretty good. And I know that the hype yesterday was looking nice. And I know that they had that investigation earlier in the week. And then over the weekend, before the week started, they had that, like they had the news of getting $1 billion in backing. I think that was great to see too. And you know, they had some nice movement yesterday. And I'm wondering if DWAC might start to go back on the uptrend here. Like, I'll be honest, Mike, I remember we talked about it on Sunday's video, and then they came out with bad news Monday morning, and we had to kind of, you know, take back our words there. But, you know, DWAC actually ended up kept going up, even with the SEC investigation and everything. It was very interesting to see, and then they got all that hype yesterday. So I don't know, it's great to see, in my opinion. And even though they're down 8% today, you have to look more at the move yesterday.
For sure. All right. So let's see. Guys, let us know what stocks you're watching. We'll probably take a look at them. Right now, we just have a lot of these growth stocks tanking off. So that's just, you know, that sucks, but it is what it is. It looks like we have Mass Money saying, what about PayPal? Lost my gains overnight. Calls expiring tomorrow. 195 strike call. Perfect. So we have a strike price. So 195 strike call expiring tomorrow. Not sure how much you paid for it, but it looks like this option has like a 60% chance of expiring worthless tomorrow. So most likely this option will be worth $0 tomorrow. So keep that in mind. And it just looks like stocks are pulling back. So maybe if it holds this like 194 support and then really holds it and bounces, it could be good. But just keep in mind, most likely it will be worthless tomorrow.
Yeah, the chances of this one winning are going to be kind of low, I think, especially with the way it's dipping down. If PayPal was at like 197 right now, the chances would probably be a lot higher. So it just depends also how it ends up moving today. With the way it just fell through the support, it is a little bit scary in my opinion. So I don't know. You know, I'd say the chances of it coming back are going to be pretty low. But, you know, just keep in mind, it was a risky play to start out with. So in the end, you know, don't be too upset if this one loses. But in the end, you know, I feel like that PayPal's in a great spot for the longer term. You know, of course, in the short term, it can go anywhere. But I feel like it's had a great week and it might consolidate like we talked about some other stocks doing. But I love them for the long term, Mike. I think if you wanted to get shares or even leaps down here, I think that's a much better way to go.
Yeah, I would say shares personally, but leaps aren't bad. It's just like the IV and then also just like the market sentiment. I mean, either way, it's not bad. It's just like personally, I'd get the shares.
Yeah, I know lots of people have been buying lots of leaps of other stuff over the past like 6 months to a year, like all these growth stocks. And I know they've been getting destroyed, but maybe now will be the time for some leaps, you know, like who knows, like if it goes straight up, the leaps will do pretty good. But you know, if it consolidates for a few months, then the leaps will get destroyed. So you definitely have to factor that in. And you know, hey, if you really like it for the long term, maybe you could get some shares and maybe a leap, because maybe a leap will just, you know, you might get that exposure to some of those quicker gains in the short term, and then you can just keep holding the shares.
So we have Mass Money saying he doesn't buy shares. So always trust your gut. I mean, I think that's a huge, huge mistake, but always trust your gut. And then, yeah. All right. And then we have Mike saying, I believe that the market is waiting on the CPI. Yeah, that information is normally pretty big. And I know that obviously if the CPI comes in bad, then, you know, that could affect a lot of different industries and just the market overall. So definitely going to be a big catalyst pretty soon. Tom, are you seeing like any news or anything major?
You know, I'm scrolling through the news to try to see some news possibly about the possible numbers coming out tomorrow or just anything like that. And I'm not seeing too much. I see some stuff here about Powell, the FAA research grants aimed to tackle aviation's massive deficit of greener fuel. So that can be good. CVS says it expects sales to accelerate. Maybe that'll be a good catalyst for CVS this morning. And speak of the devil, they're actually doing pretty well, I'll be honest, up 2.7%. They've been on a pretty good uptrend this year, Mike, ever since COVID happened. Honestly, CVS has been on fire. And look at this on the daily. If they start to break out, this could make for a pretty good momentum play, actually. So thank you, CNBC.
Exactly. CVS has been looking pretty good. And I want to say a couple months ago, I saw a lot of smart money getting into some long-term calls. So you know that, you know, you could say that was a pretty good timing, but either way, I mean, they are getting pretty close to a breakout. They're a solid company and they probably will do pretty good.
Yeah, and this is kind of funny, Mike. Look at this. I actually on my chart have it marked down from back whenever me and you were talking about it a ton back in like November and December of last year, believe it or not. Huh. And then look at where it is now. So yeah, definitely had some crazy movement over that time. And it's just crazy sometimes when you go back to the chart and see some stuff you put down like over a year ago on a stock you haven't looked at in a while.
Exactly. All right. And then we have Anderson saying, good morning, fellas. What are your thoughts on NIO? Thanks. Yeah, we'll take a look. NIO is up like 0.3% today. They're not really moving too much, but they are holding their ground, which I would say is a pretty good thing relative to the market today. A lot of stocks are in the red. We're not really seeing any stocks like crashing, you can say, but a lot of stocks are pulling back, especially growth plays kind of like NIO. So the fact that they are holding their ground is a good sign. They are above that $35 support. They're at a pretty good level. I like them. Honestly, I like them for shares the best right now, or short puts. But Tom, I know you got a little short-term play going.
Yeah, definitely. I do with NIO. I love it. I think it could be pretty good. Now, keep in mind, though, that with the play, it's not it's not the shortest term. You know, it does have a couple months, which is good. I know lots of people might hear that and think, like, I have a play that expires, like, Friday or something. But keep in mind, it does have a couple months. So we do have a couple days of consolidation that we can work with and stuff. So that's good, at least. If you guys are going to play this, I would recommend getting at least a month or two on it. I think that would be a lot smarter of a way to go. And looking at it, though, I love the movement, Mike. And whenever I look at it intraday, I love how it's holding up above that 35 and 34 support. I think those two levels are great. It's up above the 1,000 SMA, which is awesome too. And I feel like for the next couple of weeks, it could definitely get a boost back. And, you know, honestly, they haven't really recovered too much, in my opinion. I feel like that they've went up at a slower pace than some of the other stocks like DraftKings and stuff like that. So I'm really looking for like more of an explosive move, possibly like next week out of them. And I'm really waiting for them to come back up and retest $40. I think that's going to be the big resistance over the next week or two.
There we go. All right. And then we have Ironical saying, so far, flat and boring day for the market. Yeah, so far it's definitely been pretty boring. There's not really too much going on. Like we already covered, like, Lucid is tanking down, but, you know, that's not really that eye-catching. I know Twitter's doing pretty well. But honestly, Tom, in my opinion, I think the top stocks watch for the upside today are the China stocks. I mean, they're leading my watch list. Baidu's up almost 3%. Baba's at 1.5%. And, you know, they're definitely trending up there.
Yeah, they are. They're looking pretty decent, actually. I was pretty surprised to see Baba doing this well. I know that their pre-market wasn't going the best, but I'm so glad to see him moving like this. I know that, like we talked about earlier, Baidu was doing way better. And yeah, their chart looks pretty awesome the way they broke out above that 150-250 resistance. I think that was a really nice break right there. And overall, these China stocks are crazy. I can't believe that they're moving up as drastically as they are. And it looks like Baidu is almost double bottoming down here around 135, Mike. This could be a pretty good, yeah, I think that some of these China stocks might be pretty good pickups for the longer term down here. Now, like we talk about, you know, unfortunately, I believe it's more of a share play down here. You know, the IV can get a little crazy with these China stocks. And you know, of course, a leap could work out well for them, but it's just a little bit riskier, of course, just like it will be with anything. And I feel like that with how volatile they are, you'll want to have some time and possibly some extra, you know, some extra margins there just in case the stock goes crazy.
Makes sense. All right, cool. Well, Tom, like, what setups are you seeing? Like, do you have like any favorite setups or any thoughts on the market or anything you're watching?
You know, yesterday I was really eyeing up FLSY, but I do have some thoughts on the market in a second. But Fastly was looking pretty awesome, I think, to the upside. You know, they are consolidating today, but I'll be honest, it's setting up kind of like Baidu. And it looks like just like a lot of these other growth stocks, it's double bottoming around $34. I think it looks really solid to the upside for shares or even possibly for leaps. But like we keep saying, you know, shares is definitely going to be the better way to go. And personally, I'm getting a lot of shares at this time. I might get some leaps or maybe some options as we start to go on the uptrend. But as of right now, in my personal accounts, I'm getting lots of shares on these for the long term. And I really like it. You know, I feel like Fastly could be a good play for the long term. AI is another one pulling back today, pretty big, that I feel like is at a great level. RUN is another one. Even Boeing. Boeing's like leading my watch list to the downside as well, down 1.6%. But I feel like they're also at a good long-term pickup. You know, like we've been saying for the past couple of weeks, a lot of these stocks are at awesome levels. And I really hope that it continues with this nice momentum that we've had this week. And as far as the SPY goes, man, I'm really curious about how these inflation numbers are going to be tomorrow, Mike. Like, we have the CPI data coming out, and I feel like every time that this data has been coming out lately, it's been posting like I've been seeing news lately, like the last time the CPE data, I think it was, came out, they said it was like the highest CPE in 10 years. And, you know, I've been hearing some crazy numbers like that. So it's going to be very interesting, I think. You know, like, the market is flat today, I think, in anticipation of these CPI numbers tomorrow. And if the numbers come in better than expected, like, the market might explode to the upside and we might see some awesome movement. But if they come in worse, we might see some huge, like a huge sell-off. So it's just, it's really hard to say as well, because now, Mike, I know this is where you follow stuff a little bit more than I do, is whenever the CPI data, whenever these numbers come out, if they come out worse than expected, you know, we might hear, like, there's been analysts saying that Powell might come out and talk about raising rates sooner or tapering bond purchasing faster and stuff like that. And I feel like that's more of where the CPI data comes into play, because it's really going to matter what the Fed does with this data tomorrow. And I think that it's going to be such a big day. And I just kind of want to hear your thoughts on it, because it's going to be crazy with TLT and all these rate ETFs and stuff.
Yeah, absolutely. I mean, like, just the inflation data and, you know, I guess you could say bond prices and interest rates have such a large influence, not only on the U.S. economy and in the stock market and the global economy. It's just like, it's so important, because it affects everything from, you know, how much you're paying, you know, like interest for your mortgage, to the valuations of certain companies, to everything, you know. So it's very, very important. And, you know, the actions that the Fed takes will it'll be very important. You know, like, we could draw up all these hypothetical scenarios, like, if this happens and Powell might do this, but either way, I mean, the data will be important tomorrow. And I would say it'll also be extremely important what Powell says at the next FOMC press conference, which is pretty soon. So we definitely have a lot of interesting events to wrap up the year. With that being said, though, I will say the market has had a pretty good turnaround over the past week. I know we've been looking at the market over the past month, and been a little shaky. You know, the SPY was down to 450, but I would say, like, the past week, buyers really stepped in and at least, like, relieved some of my stress, you know, because the growth stocks are back, they're holding their ground, which is great to see. And, you know, I'm excited to see how the year ends.
Yeah, you're right. That was actually a really good stress reliever to see the market come up this week, to see these growth stocks do well. I think it was awesome, and I'm really glad that the market turned around, because, you know, for those couple of weeks, like, just a couple of weeks ago, Mike, like, all that we were hearing was Omicron variant fears and, you know, like, more cases in the U.S. And then, you know, the vaccines aren't going to work against Omicron. And, you know, just all this stuff. We were even hearing, like, bad China news and, you know, possibly, like, BD getting delisted and, like, all this crazy stuff. And I'm just so glad to see it turn around. Like you said, it was really good for the mental game, you know, just for stress reasons and just everything like that. I think it really helps us. And I think it also gives investors some more confidence. You know, like, it shows that a lot of these growth stocks, I think, are bouncing on supports. And if they would have kept going down, it could have maybe accelerated a sell-off. But I think it was great to see the market turn around like this. And like we said, tomorrow's going to be a pretty big day with the numbers, and it's going to probably impact the market in a big way. So hopefully we see it break up above 470 and we see a nice breakout. And hopefully the inflation's not getting bad again, because, man, it seems like every time these numbers come out lately, the inflation's getting bad. And, you know, it's getting so bad that Powell had to even take away his term transitory. I remember just a couple weeks ago, he's like, I think it's time to retire that term. So it was pretty funny to hear him say that. But apparently inflation is no longer transitory in Powell's eyes. And, you know, I feel kind of bad, because I feel like he was kind of misleading a lot of people and a lot of different analysts and stuff like that. But, you know, he's doing his job, he's keeping the market up, but he was kind of misleading people during that time.
Yeah, it is true. It is true. I mean, he definitely has a tough job. You know, not too many people in the world can do it, especially over the past couple of years, you know, so I definitely respect him for that, but he's done pretty good with the market. So good stuff there. We have Vicky saying, hit the like, guys. Yeah, if you guys could hit that like button, it would help Tom and myself out so much. It takes like 2 seconds, and we would greatly appreciate it. Thank you guys so much for joining the stream. Then we have Irangle saying, MasterCard and Disney starting to go up. There we go. You know, MasterCard is definitely, wow, MasterCard actually had a really nice pop-up. I haven't even been following this one too much, but it's not looking bad.
Yeah, it's not. They came up like with the overall market with the growth stocks. And then today they're kind of outperforming, you know, they're up in the green here, doing pretty well. And if they could start to break out up above the high of yesterday more of than what they did already, it'll be great. Like, if they could get up to 350 or something like that, they would have a very explosive move. And then with Disney, yeah, I mean, Disney's looking pretty good also. And man, same thing with them. If they could break their high of yesterday, maybe they'll start to run up, and possibly this could almost like pull the market up. Like, maybe we'll see a turnaround with a lot of these stocks. Like, I know today's been pretty slow so far. And, you know, if we start to pick a direction to the upside, it could be pretty good.
Yeah. All right. And then we have Irangle saying, or then he mentioned Disney as well, which is another pretty good one. I know they've been doing pretty good overall. They're definitely holding their ground. And I just can't believe they fell all the way down to 142. I mean, they were at 175. They reported bad earnings, which, you know, I understand why the stock fell then, but to drop all the way to 142, it's crazy. So I still think that they're at a good level, and I bet we'll see a recovery pretty, I would say within like the next couple months.
Yeah, I would too. And, you know, they have a nice gap to fill on the daily from like 164 to 175. So definitely eye that up. I feel like that they got to fill that gap eventually back to the upside. And I'm really going to watch it, Mike. And honestly, I've been a little sad with how much they've been going up the past few days, because I was really wanting to get some shares on them around like 140 to 142. And they only stayed there for like one day. It was a, you know, it was pretty hard to get that entry down there. But either way, the entry here at 153 to 155 still isn't bad. But, you know, it's just, it's been a really good week for some of these stocks. And I hope Disney continues up. Whenever I look at them on the 5-minute, you know, they're looking pretty good this morning, especially if they can break out above like 154.33.
For sure. All right. And then we have Vicky saying STNE and MGNI, FVRR for day trade, please. Support and resistance. All right, Tom. So we got the first one. We have STNE, levels for a day trade.
I haven't heard about this stock in a long time, but for a day trade, this one's going to be pretty tough, I think. It looks like they had a pretty explosive move here at market open. I'm trying to find some.
Oh, Tom, can you still hear me? Looks like we might have some connection issues. Let's see. Let me know if you can hear me, Tom. Let's see. Sorry, guys, on this technical problem. Give us 1 second. Let's see. All right, I'm working with Tom. Give me 1 second, guys. Sorry for this problem. Let's see. Let's see. Oops. All right, so Tom should be joining back in a second. All right. Let's see. Tom, can you hear me? Let's see. Can you hear me, Tom? All right. I don't know if Tom could hear me. Okay. All right. You hear me, Tom?
Hey, I hear you.
All right. There we go. There we go. We're back. All right. Sorry about that problem, guys. We are back. Tom, as you were saying with STNE, I don't know if you just want to start from the beginning.
Yeah, definitely. It kind of cut out right as I started, which was good timing, I guess, in that sense. But looking at it, I will say I have to go back pretty far here to get a solid resistance level on STNE. I have to go all the way back to whenever they took this huge drop to the downside a few weeks ago. And looking at it, I will say there's a pretty big resistance here, right around $19.20. And I will say we hit that today. So it's going to be a pretty big resistance. I think this is going to be a pretty big one to watch today. Whenever you're looking at it, I think that go ahead and make it break out above 1920. That's going to be the main level to look for. And as a support, you can use the intraday level of 1850, I think is a good intraday support. But, you know, keep in mind the main level to look for, I think, is going to be that resistance at 1920, because if we do start to dip, you know, it's had an explosive recovery the past few days. Like, it might go down pretty drastically. So hopefully we see it break out above 1920.
And then I would say there's also a decent amount of support right at 18 or so. With the next one, we had MGNI.
MGNI. Let's check that one out. Now this one is going down kind of into a support here. I will say I'm seeing a little bit of intraday support more of down here, again, right at $18. I don't know how it worked out that good for both stocks to be right around 18, but it looks like 18 is going to be good on MGNI as a support. Now, as a resistance, there's going to be a couple of levels. I think the main one's going to be here right around 18.70, but after that, look at like $19 even, of course, where it hit today. And let me go back a little further just to make sure that I'm not missing anything. And yeah, I'm definitely going to say like $19 even will be the main resistance to the upside, with $18 being the main support.
All right. And then with the last one, Tom, we have Fiverr.
Fiverr, F-E-R-R. Now, this one, I feel like could go on a pretty good recovery if we start to see these stocks go up, like the growth stocks and stuff. And to be honest, Fiverr had a pretty good move this morning, it looks like, but they came right back down. With them, I'm definitely seeing a pretty big resistance right around 145.50. We got pretty close to it this morning, and I would say definitely look at 145.50 as resistance. And then as support, there's going to be one right around 140, which might act as resistance now that we fell below it. But then I'm seeing another support down here around 135.50. So definitely eye those ones up. I think 135.50 will be the better support for Fiverr today, with 144 being the good upper resistance.
Awesome. All right. And then we have Vicky saying people live in fear by choice. Yeah, I completely agree with you there. 100%. And then we have Vicky saying inflation is transitory. Powell just got tired of explaining it as transitory in a macro environment is different than buying tomatoes and cucumbers. So I disagree there, but we'll definitely see what happens with it. I know there's a lot of opinions on both sides with the inflation argument, but we'll definitely get a good sense tomorrow, and especially over the next couple months. So lots of great information is coming out, and definitely great information, Vicky. Thanks so much for all the input. Good stuff. Tom, do you have any last minute stocks, options, or anything for the rest of the day?
Man, I'm just still trying to eye up some of these stocks that are moving to the downside. Like we have Lucid down 7.5%. You know, it's just, I feel like today we're getting a little bit of selling pressure, of course, out of the growth stocks. We had an explosive week so far. So just don't be surprised if we keep consolidating or just not having too much movement today. I feel like maybe tomorrow, whenever these inflation numbers come out, or possibly next week during the FOMC meetings, we'll see some more movement. So definitely be ready for next week and for tomorrow. I think it's going to be pretty important with these CPI numbers coming out. That's going to really impact the market. And I'm really just waiting for the SPY to make a move. Like I said, if we see a big move up above 471, I think we could be pretty bullish on the SPY and possibly play it to the upside. And if the numbers come out and the SPY falls below 466, I think it might be time to play some puts in the short term. But you know, either way, it's going to be really hard to gauge it with those numbers coming out tomorrow. So I would wait for the numbers to come out first and then react rather than trying to pick a direction, because it's almost like playing earnings. It's going to be very 50-50, and you never know where that implied volatility is going to go either.
There we go. So then we have Mike saying stocked up community, just 3 likes. Come on, Mike and Tom has helped us so much. So yeah, I mean, it looks like we had a pretty good stream. It looks like we're up to like 10 or 11 likes right now. So thank you guys so much for joining. You know, we had a great time. We have some interesting events for the rest of the year. One with the inflation data tomorrow, but I would say even more important would be the FOMC press conference. I believe that's on the 14th of December, so that's next week. So either way, we have a lot of great things. The market has been doing pretty well. Hopefully this uptrend continues. I'm very excited for, you know, the rest of the week and especially the rest of the year. With that being said, thank you guys so much for joining, and have an amazing rest of your day.